today. And I have just one note, my mute button isn't working today. So whatever I say, it's going to come out.
It'd be dangerous.
Anyway, with that danger, I'd like to welcome to our committee today,
Promoted.
Well, you could, in your new life. We have Chancellor Rosenstone with us. And today we're going to talk about the budget request from Minnesota State. And we have also basically scheduled this to run till about 4 o'clock. So not to rush you or not to stretch that out either. just whatever is adequate, but roughly guessing 4 o'clock would be the time we would maybe have some questions or whatever or not. So Chancellor, you can go ahead.
Thank you, Chair Normus. Members of the committee, good afternoon. For the record, I am Minnesota State Chancellor Stephen Rosenstone, and with me is Vice Chancellor and CFO Laura King. In addition to those you'll be meeting from their testimony today, we have with us several members of our Board of Trustees that I'd like to recognize. Our Board Chair, Trustee Michael Vekage, is here, Trustee Jay Coles, Trustee Cheryl Teffer, and Trustee Luis Sundin are all here today. In addition, we have several of our presidents, President Barbara McDonald from North Hennepin Community College, President Ann Blackhurst, who you'll meet in a few minutes, from Minnesota State University Moorhead, President Annette Parker, who you'll also meet in a few moments, from South Central College, and President Ginny Arthur from Metropolitan State University.
Chancellor, if I can interrupt for just a minute, we do have a quorum now, and I'd like to officially call to order the Higher Education and Career Readiness Policy and Finance Committee. And if we can take one more moment, I'd like to deal with the minutes. So we have that out of the way from February the 21st. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes? Representative Jessup, any questions, corrections? All those in favor of the minutes, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes are now approved. So, Chancellor, now back to you.
Chair Normus, members of the committee, thank you. We very really appreciate the opportunity to meet with you today to discuss our biennial budget request. We want to be respectful of the time constraint, the early adjournment, and therefore we're going to provide, if you will, a very high-level overview of our request, and we look forward to following up with individual members if there are details that you'd like us to fill in. Before we do that, though, I'd like to briefly distill what we hope you took away from last month's hearing. Our colleges and universities are focused on access, affordability, and talent. And we do so on the ground in 47 communities across Minnesota. We are about education and jobs. We are the solution to the talent challenge facing Minnesota. And as you heard from the Hennepin Tech presentation last month, our colleges and universities are the state's leaders in partnering with business and industry to meet Minnesota's workforce needs. This work is core to what we're all about. It's our mission, plain and simple. We are preparing the workforce of the future, students like Trustee Basil Ajou, whose powerful story you heard last month is just an example. We are producing the talent that Minnesota is counting on. Our graduates are key to the future prosperity of your community and our state. Our graduates are ready to do everything from managing our cities to growing our food, to building our homes and roads, to caring for us when we are sick. And Chair Normus, members of the committee, with that brief introduction and your permission, I'd like to turn the presentation over to Vice Chancellor and CFO Laura King.
Thank you. Welcome, Ms. King, to our committee.
Good afternoon, members. For the record, my name is Laura King, and I'm the Vice Chancellor of Finance and CFO for the Minnesota State System. Mr. Chair, thank you for your time this afternoon. As you heard last month, our mission to provide access, protect affordability, and help meet our state's talent shortage is something we take very seriously, and we do so with increasing efficiency. Our administrative spending is among the lowest in the country. But carrying out our mission has become increasingly difficult. No state in the country has a higher need for a well-educated workforce than Minnesota. And yet, as the slide illustrates, the state's investment in higher education over the past 20 years has tumbled. This is not a Minnesota State Colleges and Universities slide. This is a state of Minnesota slide. It illustrates that Minnesota's investment in public higher education lags the national average, though this has not always been the case. In 1995, Minnesota's per FYE funding for public higher education was 5% higher than the national average. 10 years later, in 2005, Minnesota spending per FYE on an inflation-adjusted basis lagged the national average by 9%. And by 2015, the most recent year data is available, that gap had opened up to 14%. So between 1995 and 2015, Minnesota's investment in higher education has declined at twice the national average, a decline of 29% versus 14%. Based on this 2014 data, if our colleges and universities had been funded at the national average, our state support would have been $184 million higher. Just looking at the public associate colleges, our two-year community and technical colleges, Minnesota spends 25% less than the national average on its 30 community and technical colleges. If the community and technical colleges were funded at the national average, they would have available to them an additional $113 million in state support. When we look at the public master's universities, likewise, Minnesota spends 24% less than the national average on our seven state universities. If these were funded at the national average, the universities would have $71 million more to make available to their student services. This difference has impacted all of our colleges and universities as they struggle with declining resources. The system's operating budget was essentially flat from 2016 to 2017, increasing 0.3%. Since 2007, in inflation-adjusted terms, total expenses have changed 0.5% on average per year. Since 2011, expenses have declined an average of 1% per year. In 2011, for instance, our total expenses were $1.84 billion. In 2016, total expenses were $1.87 billion, a difference of 0.5%. Over the past 5 years, our revenues have increased on average 2% a year, while our compensation costs have increased between 4% and 5% a year. In 2016, with declining enrollment and flat state support, these pressures have led to large reallocations and budget cuts. As you see on the slide, in the past 5 years, the total number of employees has declined 10%. We have reallocated a total of $181 million, including $114 million in absolute budget cuts. These cuts have eliminated jobs, closed programs, slowed technology and equipment investment. We enter fiscal 18 with a $37 million annual structural deficit before any new cost inflation is added in. Our colleges and universities are under financial pressure that is just not sustainable. In just 2016, our colleges and universities reallocated a total of $38 million, which included 9 suspended or closed programs, 121 eliminated faculty positions, and 155 eliminated staff positions. These reallocations were used in two ways. $14 million was reinvested in new programs with limited faculty and staff additions and some equipment purchases. $24 million was a straightforward budget cut. Costs were removed and programs stayed closed. Faculty and staff positions did not come back, and technology and equipment budgets were reduced. And these reductions were felt on every campus across the system. A scenario that freezes tuition and provides a low budget target with labor costs that are similar to recent years would be very devastating for our campuses. We have shared with you our concern about the long-term financial sustainability of our colleges and universities. Flat or declining revenue in the face of increasing costs is a recipe for further financial danger. The financial pressures we face are real, and they have shaped our fiscal 18-19 budget request to you.
Chair Normus, members of the committee, our Board of Trustees is deeply troubled by the funding trend in Minnesota. What keeps them up at night, and quite frankly, what keeps me and our 30 presidents up at night, is ensuring that we have the funding needed to continue the critical work that communities across Minnesota are counting on us to do, and that we have the infrastructure to support that work. 2 years ago, we asked for your support to begin reversing the dip in state investment, and you gave us that support, and for that I say thank you. Our request this year seeks to continue the progress of restoring the state's historic investment in its most precious resource, development of its human capital. The board is well aware that our $178 million request is large, but the board also understands that a request is critical. Our priorities are not nice-to-do ideas. Our priorities are must-do priorities. What's at risk here is our ability to provide access, protect affordability, and deliver the talent communities across Minnesota need. Our request, as this slide suggests, entails three components. The first component is $143 million to protect programs and campuses by funding inflationary costs at 3% each of the 2 years over the biennium. The second component we're going to return to in just a few moments, the technology request. The third component is $10 million to provide incentive grants to keep students on track and help get them across the finish line. I should note that the board is committed to freezing undergraduate tuition if this request is fully funded. And if the request is not fully funded, the board is committed to full consultation with students and presidents across the state before reaching a decision about the next step. Chair Normus, members of the committee, as we did last time we were together, we want to begin by providing the committee with a better understanding of the request from the point of view of our campuses and the students and communities they serve. With us today are two presidents and their chief financial officers. President Ann Blackhurst has led Minnesota State University Moorhead since 2014, and for 3 years before that, she was MSU Moorhead's provost and senior vice president for academic affairs. President Annette Parker has led South Central College in North Mankato and Faribault since 2013. Dr. Parker is one of our nation's leaders in advanced manufacturing. She served on a national steering committee co-chaired by the president of MIT and the president of Dow Chemical that has advised the White House on advanced manufacturing strategy and policy. Chair Nornes, members of the committee, with your permission, I'd like to turn the presentation over to Presidents Blackhurst and Parker and their CFOs.
They are welcome to come on down. There are enough chairs? I guess so. Welcome to the committee, and is Moorhead first?
Good afternoon. Yeah. For the record, I'm Ann Blackhurst, president of Minnesota State University Moorhead. And before I begin this afternoon, I'd like to thank all of you for your service to our state and the Higher Education Policy and Finance Committee. I especially want to thank you, Chair Nornes, and Representative Lean, who just happens to be an alumnus of MSUM, for your support of our university and your service to our region. As Chancellor Rosenstone noted, this is my sixth year at Minnesota State University Moorhead. In total, I've served the Minnesota State system for 23 years, and I'm extremely proud of the work we do. I am, of course, particularly proud of my university and its contributions to meeting the workforce needs of our region. At MSUM, we prepare the teachers that are desperately needed in Clay County, where we cannot build schools fast enough to accommodate the growing population. We prepare the nurses for a regional healthcare industry that is not experiencing merely a nursing shortage, but a nursing crisis. And we represent hope and opportunity for the fastest growing communities in Fargo-Moorhead, where 36 different languages are spoken in our public schools. With input from local business and industry leaders, we've reallocated resources to add new programs in high-demand fields: business analytics, geospatial information systems, project management, healthcare administration, and new media. We're also partnering with major healthcare providers such as Sanford and Essentia to substantially increase the number of bachelor's prepared nurses in our region. All across our system, colleges and universities are innovating to meet workforce needs and provide access to underserved communities in our state. But financial pressures seriously threaten our ability to continue that innovation. Every year for the past 6 years, Minnesota State University Moorhead has faced multi-million dollar deficits. The upcoming biennium is no different. Even with projected increases in our enrollment, our expenses will outpace our revenues by more than $8 million over the next 2 years. That is why the Minnesota State budget request, which would allocate about $7 million to MSUM over the biennium, is critical to our financial sustainability. When I say that expenses will outpace our revenues, I want to be sure you know that I'm not talking about unnecessary spending. Our $70 million budget is extraordinarily lean for a university our size. Over the past decade, we have substantially reduced the number of administrators on our campus. We have found innovative ways to reduce our energy costs. We have raised millions of dollars in private funding and continually evaluated the relevance and the sustainability of our programs, making very difficult decisions about how to strategically allocate our resources. Sadly, we have also had to reduce student support staff and services that are critical to the support of the success of our students. We have eliminated academic programs that, while important to the workforce needs of our region, are expensive to offer because of technology and equipment needs. We have issued layoff notices to employees who have devoted their careers, and in many ways their lives, to MSUM and the students we serve. Without additional funding, MSUM will have no choice but to make additional cuts, cuts that further jeopardize our ability to serve our students and our region. The consequences of those cuts will lead to reduced enrollment, further financial strain, and ultimately an erosion of quality, access, and opportunity, jeopardizing our ability to meet the extraordinary need for an educated workforce in our region. Before our Chief Financial Officer, Gene Holler, shares more detail about the impossible financial decisions we face at the university, I want to emphasize that our students and their families face the same impossible choices as they struggle to afford college. That's why the $10 million in student success incentive grant funding is so important to reducing the educational and economic disparities that exist in our state. $500 grants to students who pursue a transfer pathway program will serve as an important incentive for students to complete their education at one of our state universities.
Thank you, President Blackhurst. And I'll introduce yourself again for the record and then proceed with your testimony.
Chair Nornes and members of the committee, for the record, my name is Jean Holler and I am the Vice President for Finance and Administration at MSU Moorhead. Although I have only been in this position for 2 years, I have been a part of this great university for over 30 years in a variety of roles. I am passionate about the purpose of higher education in general, public higher education in general, and at MSUM in particular. I'm a proud alum of MSUM, and my oldest son is currently a student at the university studying construction management. The first thing I want to impress upon you is that funding inflation for the campuses does not mean that institutions are spending more money on the same things. We are constantly looking for ways to remain efficient, effective, and relevant in order to accomplish our mission, which is to transform the world by transforming lives. In fact, we review all university expenditures each year in relation to the available revenue. And even in times when revenues and expenditures balance, we make reallocations from low priorities to higher ones. To illustrate, MSU Moorhead has made over $6 million in reallocations during the last two fiscal years. Because employee compensation represents over 75% of our expenditures, reallocation really means people and positions. During budget planning for the last 2 years, 54 positions were reallocated after employees retired, resigned, or their temporary assignments ended. Of those, 16 instructional faculty positions were reallocated to recruitment and retention efforts in order to stabilize enrollment, and 34 were eliminated to balance the budget. MSUM has also experienced operating budget pressure due to the lack of capital bonding and HEPR funding. After a 3-inch rainfall last September, water came flowing out of an electrical outlet in the Dill Center for the Arts building on campus. It was due to a cracked storm sewer line, even though that line was 6 feet below the ground and 75 feet away from the outlet. The water also washed up about 3 cubic yards of subsoil from under the building. The sewer main that caused these issues on our campus has been on our HEPR request for the last several years. Additionally, during the recent warm weather, we experienced interior damage in 7 different areas of our campus bookstore due to a leaky roof. McLean Hall roof replacement is our number one project on the 2017 HEPR list. These two issues alone have resulted in over $140,000 in repairs, which further strain our already tight operating budget. MSUM relies on state appropriation to serve our students and our region. Without the requested legislative funding support, MSUM will be forced to make reductions that will jeopardize critical academic and student support services that are necessary to recruit and serve the needs of an increasingly diverse student body. We will be forced to eliminate faculty and staff positions and to defer technology and facilities investments necessary to ensure safety, security, and operational efficiencies. Ultimately, these cuts will result in an erosion of quality, access, and opportunity. Thank you, and with that, I will turn it over to President Parker.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Chair Nonis, members of the committee, for the record, I am South Central College President Annette Parker. South Central College is privileged to be a member of the statewide system of colleges and universities working together to make the most out of our resources for our students. One example is the $15 million U.S. Department of Labor grant that South Central College received in 2015. South Central College applied for the grant on behalf of the Minnesota Advanced Manufacturing Partnership, a consortium of 12 Minnesota State colleges and 2 Minnesota State Centers of Excellence, working together to eliminate the skills gaps in manufacturing. It is absolutely imperative to provide our businesses in Minnesota with the talented technical workforce they so desperately need, for our students with access to the tremendous opportunities available in today's high-tech manufacturing environment. Of course, manufacturing is just one of the industries important to Minnesota, and this is just one example of the collaborations amongst our schools. As Chancellor Rosenstein mentioned, as part of our legislative request includes $10 million for student success incentive grants. One portion of these funds would provide $500 grants to students who are succeeding academically but might need help financially. These funds make a difference as to whether students will not only graduate, but whether they will persist and come back the next semester. Their paths may be different, but the end goal is always the same: provide opportunities for our students while meeting the workforce needs of our communities. Unfortunately, due to budget constraints last year, we had to make difficult decisions that compromised our ability to meet the needs of our communities in a very critical area. We had to suspend a program in human services area, community social services. I can tell you that this was a heart-wrenching decision. The 70 students in the program either currently worked in social services, and came to us for additional education or had dreams of begin working in the field serving others. However, because of its cost to the institution compared to other programs, we found it was impossible to continue. The reason we discontinued the program was not because it was not a good program, not because we didn't have students in the program, not because we didn't have jobs available, and not because there wasn't a community need. We discontinued the program because we couldn't afford it. Ladies and gentlemen, Minnesota State cannot afford to do without programs like this. Yes, our colleges and universities are working together through programs such as the Advanced Manufacturing Partnership, but that is simply not sustainable. We need ongoing support for programs such as manufacturing and human services, programs that meet the critical workforce needs of Minnesota and provide opportunities for our students. We are making the most of the resources we have, but we simply do not have enough resources to do what is right for Minnesota. I know that it's not what any of us want for our state and for our students. I'd now like to introduce South Central College's Vice President of Finance and Operations, David Armstrong. David is a U.S. Army veteran with extensive experience in community college and university finances and operations. Prior to joining South Central College, he served as the Assistant Dean for Administration and Finance at the University of Wisconsin, Baraboo, Sauk County, a campus of UW Colleges and Extension. David?
Thank you, Dr. Parker. Mr. Armstrong, welcome to the committee.
Thank you, sir. Chair Nornes, members of the committee, for the record, I am South Central College Vice President for Finance and Operations, David Armstrong. Like most community and technical colleges in the state and throughout the nation, we are facing financial and enrollment challenges, primarily due to an improving economy as adults return to work and a declining number of high school graduates who are entering as first-time students. Although we have experienced a recent growth in enrollment at our Faribault campus after a period of significant construction, which was funded through Minnesota State bonding, our enrollment overall has declined. As Dr. Parker mentioned, SCC has had to make difficult choices in a number of areas during the last two biennia. We have reduced college-wide general fund spending by more than $2 million annually, which represents approximately 5.5% of our general fund budget. Some of this has been accomplished through cost-saving measures in facilities and utilities management and reductions in departmental supplies, expenses, and travel. However, as the majority of our budget is devoted to payroll, much like MSU, 75 to 80% of our budget is payroll, the majority of our cost savings have been achieved through reductions in people. SCC has cut more than 40 full and part-time positions since fiscal year 13, or roughly 11% of our workforce. This includes permanent reductions in the number of administrative, managerial, and faculty positions. We were able to accomplish this, most of this, through natural attrition, as employees voluntarily retired or left for other jobs. However, that was not enough, and we have been forced to move to involuntary separations, including two layoffs and three early retirements in the last fiscal year alone. We are also substituting more part-time and intermittent positions for formerly permanent positions. We are happy that the economy continues to improve within Minnesota and nationwide. However, we are a countercyclical industry that is more than ever reliant on tuition and state support to continue our operations. Our colleges and universities face financial difficulties. If employee salaries and fringe costs continue to rise while tuition levels are kept constant or even reduced, as in the past fiscal year, South Central College and most other Minnesota State institutions will have few options but to continue reducing our instructional and student support workforce, deferring needed maintenance, and limiting the number of programs available to our students. Thank you for your time and support. Dr. Parker.
Thank you. If I can ask Dr. or President Blackhurst one question. Mm-hmm. I have a grandson that's due to graduate this spring at Moorhead. Do you know the date for that graduation? I need to plan ahead here a little bit. So. I didn't mean to put you on the spot, but
it's a Friday in May. I know that.
Friday in May. That's helpful. Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Chair Nornis, members of the committee, the stories that Presidents Blackhurst and Parker and their CFOs have told you about their campuses illustrate how all of our campuses are struggling. They are struggling to protect the programs that produce the workforce and talent their communities need. They are struggling to meet the needs of our students. That's what's at risk. And our request is critical because it meets the needs of communities across Minnesota. We want to share with you the importance of the second component of our request, the replacement of our information system. It has a catchy name, the Integrated Statewide Record System, or ISRS for short. Now, I have to tell you, proposing a technology overhaul is not something I dreamed of as part of my last legislative request. Our request is kind of the heaper of technology. It's not like putting on a fancy new addition to your house. It's more like fixing a big crack in the foundation that threatens the entire enterprise. And just as you can't ignore a big crack in your foundation, this is a case where a decades-old core information system just has to be upgraded. It's a dinosaur that's been kept alive by some very ingenious IT people, but it is not sustainable. The risk of doing nothing is too great, and we must act now.
Chair Nornis and members of the committee, the Minnesota State Data System is one of the largest data systems in the higher education system, among higher education systems in the country. We alone are the fourth largest system, and we operate what we think to be the only single enterprise legacy data system nationwide. Ours is a single enterprise, enterprise system, which is a tremendous competitive advantage for us. Most state systems have multiple technology systems, often school by school, at a much higher price. We've been watching these other higher education systems for several years now, and we've been watching the industry. We're now at the point where the risks of doing nothing are too great, and the needs of our students and staff are too great. Today, our platform has 32 integrated modules developed using a combination of 5 programming languages that support 376,000 students in a $1.9 billion enterprise. Our CIO hosted listening sessions across the state this past year in 31 locations with over 1,000 participants, faculty, staff, and students, and they gave him unanimous support to go forward with a proposal to start what nobody wants to go through, which is a large enterprise replacement project. In addition, 1,300 of our students and employees participated in an online survey as part of this listening process. All of this outreach told us that we needed technology that provides strong support for student advising, academic planning, career planning, and student success techniques like online tutoring that integrates all the components of our current software in order to leverage all of the data that we're accumulating about our work and that improves our security and firewall capability. Given the 5-year runway to complete this work, it's critical that we get started now before there is a real crisis. As the Chancellor said, this is not a nice to do, it's a must do. Mr. Chair, with your permission, I'd like to bring someone to the table with us. We have with us Kim Lynch, who's our System Director for Educational Innovations. Ms. Lynch has been a faculty member, a dean, a chief information officer, and the parent of several Minnesota State students, all of which makes her ideal to help us describe to you the experience that we're seeking from every angle.
Thank you, Ms. King, and welcome to the committee. Please identify yourself for the record.
Chair Nornis, members of the committee, for the record, my name is Kim Lynch, and I'm the Senior System Director for Educational Innovations at Minnesota State. I expect it is no surprise to any of you that technology has changed lightning speed in the decades since ISRS, the original, was developed. Students, faculty, and staff have high expectations for student success and they're ready for change. For example, 2/3 of the students surveyed said they own 3 or more devices they use to access the internet and consequently the work that they're trying to do. Over 90% said their device is important for academic success, and over 60% said that handheld access is important for academic activities. In addition, many of our students attend more than one college or university at the same time, and they expect to be able to do so without unnecessary obstacles. The current system is a significant roadblock to our students tapping into the riches of our system and makes it nearly impossible for faculty and staff to connect directly with our students. Next-gen ISRs can make a deep and meaningful difference because it is mobile, because it is adaptive, and because it paves the way to natural user interfaces. Specifically, here's what Minnesotans can gain from this investment. 1, mobility. Students, faculty, and staff will be able to use the power of their smart devices to access what they need, when they need it, wherever they are, across multiple devices. It's a far cry from what they can do right now. Secondly, adaptive and personal experiences. Every student's path is unique. Next-gen ISRS lets us personalize experiences, push out important notifications, offer just-in-time interventions, and generally, just stay closely and personally connected to our students, ultimately ensuring that fewer students fall through the cracks. Thirdly, natural user interface. Investment in next-gen ISRS is the first step to remove all barriers for Minnesotans. Think about touch screens, gesture sensors, voice recognition, making connection as intuitive as possible. We can't get there. We can't even get close with our current technology. Next-gen ISRS is decades ahead of the current complicated clicks and convoluted paths. Next-gen ISRS offers a competitive advantage and greater likelihood our students actually make it into and through our colleges and universities, especially for those whose opportunities already put them at a significant disadvantage. We're asking you to invest in Minnesota State so students, faculty, and staff can return that investment to Minnesota. Chair Nornes, members of the committee, with your permission, I'll turn the presentation back to Vice Chancellor King.
Ms. King? Thank you, Ms. Lynch. Thank you very much.
Mr. Chair and members, we have received state support for technology twice in the past 20 years. With that support and internal resources, we have built all the systems in place today. This is a once-in-a-generation investment, one that we will finance over several years. We are asking for the state's investment help to get this done. Our proposal is for a 50-50 finance plan. We are asking for $12.5 million a year as an addition to our base, and we will turn to internal financing for the remainder of the project cost. This is a very tough one for us. We have colleges and universities under financial stress that are working hard to balance their budgets and preserve their services to students. But the risks to our students, colleges, and universities are simply too great for us not to begin to transition this platform before the technology breaks and can't be fixed, before the industry pulls out support for our operating systems completely, and before we have a crisis, such as a data breach, that stops the whole organization. We need the state's commitment of base support in order to move this work forward. We can't sign contracts we don't have financed, and we can't ask the colleges and universities to support more than 50% of the development cost. We need the state's partnership. It's in the state's interest to help us to have an effective, stable, and high-functioning data system to serve students and our communities.
Chair Nornes, members of the committee, I'd like to conclude by offering a few observations by someone who's completing his 44th year in higher education. I can tell you that never in my lifetime have I seen a more risky moment for the things we all care about. We are at risk as a state, and what's at risk here is the state of Minnesota. What's at risk is the ability of our state to develop the talent that businesses need to drive the state's continued economic prosperity. And what's at risk is our ability to eliminate the disparities that keep too many Minnesotans from having the opportunity to become that talent. I know that over the months ahead, the legislature will have to weigh many funding requests, ours among them. What I hope is that you'll keep in mind is that the lack of funding for our colleges and universities will have a real, real impact, not only on our campuses, as you've heard, but on the people who work with students on those campuses, on the students who attend, and it will have an impact on businesses and communities across Minnesota who are depending on our graduates. You know, Minnesota has garnered a well-deserved reputation as being the nation's brain power state. We garnered that reputation because previous generations of Minnesotans made the investments in higher education that were needed to produce one of the world's most highly educated and talented workforces. But today, we no longer lead the nation. We have fallen behind in the talent race. And we either turn this around by start investing the way that you'd expect the brain power state to do, or too many people will be left behind. Businesses will not have the people they need to continue to grow. Some businesses will end up leaving Minnesota, and we won't be able to attract other businesses to our state. Chair Nornes, members of the committee, that concludes our presentation, and Vice Chancellor King and I look forward to the discussion and to your questions. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much. And we will now take questions from the members. First, before we do that, just again, thank everyone that's here in the audience and who's been listening for the last almost hour. And thank you for being here. Representative Belowski, you have the first question. Yeah,
thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to go back to the ISRS Next Generation system. Can you explain the number of years you're actually requesting this match and the total cost of the system?
Mr. Chair, Representative Belowski, certainly. What we have brought to you is a proposal that would have $12.5 million a year added to our base. And with that support, we won't come back to you again on this proposal. We will match that with a $12.5 million a year contribution from our colleges and universities. It's about a six-year project plan. About $150 million in total is the estimated cost. At the end of the project, we expect the carrying costs of the new software to be about equal to the provision in our base budget. So we'll transition the state's base contribution from project dollars to operating dollars.
Mr. Chair, so when the project's done, you're not going to stop the base adjustment, you're going to absorb it into something else.
Mr. Chair, Representative Pulaski, we would look for your support to use those base dollars to pay the operating costs for the new system.
Mr. Chair,
Representative Pulaski,
and Vice Chancellor, there have been some concerns raised, not about the need necessarily by faculty, but about the way the money is going to be developed from the campuses. And you've been rather frank in saying this is coming from the campuses, not from the central office. And it's coming from the campuses at a time when we just heard testimony about water coming up through electrical outlets and a number of other HEPR requests that are dire, that have to be fixed. So when you keep saying there's unanimous support, is there unanimous support from all of the constituencies inside Minnesota State that they're going to do the other 50% share of this?
Mr. Chair, Representative Pulaski, I'm smiling because it may not surprise you there was unanimous support, but for the project and for the need for the project, but only if, quote, someone else paid for it.
Yeah.
It's absolutely the case that this is a tough one for us. It's a tough one for our presidents. It's yet another thing competing on campus for their difficult budget problems, but they are completely supportive of the need to do it.
Well, Mr.
And
Chair,
recognize the challenge.
Mr. Chair, you and I were in a meeting with the governor a little over a week ago when this issue came up. And there was a statement made that the faculty did not support this and I corrected the statement that was being made to the governor at the time, that they supported the initiative, but they had strong concerns about how it was going to be funded and from where. And I want to clarify that now, that they do support the need.
That's right.
But we all have concerns about where this money is going to come from and how it's going to be used. And then if it's a 6 or 7 year project, that you still get to have the money even though the project's done.
Mr. Chairperson Pawlowski, we'll be happy to come back in year 6 and have that conversation if you'd like. I appreciate that observation. Let me put a slightly different context on this. We could have come to you this year with a request that was $178 million plus $150 million, which is what this would amount to had we not proposed a 50-50 finance plan. There is absolutely no doubt that those are two really big numbers and two sets of competing demands on our budget process. And so we struggled in the leadership council with the presidents and in our internal community to sort out how are we going to do two really critical things. And this is the proposal we brought to you. It is difficult for our campuses. There is not $75 million in the system office. The money that the system has to contribute to this is on the campuses. It's not in system reserves in my bottom drawer somewhere. So if we want to do this internally, we have to look to the campuses.
Chancellor Rosenstone, did you have a comment?
No, I'm comfortable. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, Representative Pawlowski.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, thank you. Vice Chancellor King, I appreciate that. I just want clarity on the totality of the cost once we go down this path, should we go down it. On page 7, you have your request in sort of a bullet point here. And I've asked this question each cycle, and I'm going to ask it again. Is this in order of priority? So would I take the 143 as your number one priority and the next generation as your number two and the student grants as your number three? Is there a priority to this?
Mr. Chair, Trustee Representative Pawlowski, we don't have a board priority order in this request. We didn't ask them to prioritize them, and so we don't have for you here a priority order.
Well, Mr. Chair, Vice Chancellor King, and you've heard this from me before, we do.
Mm-hmm.
We have to have priorities.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to address needs based on priorities. Mm-hmm. So I would suggest that, and I say it, and I know I'm not going to get it, but that it might be a good idea to start coming up with one.
Mr. Chair and Representative Pawlowski, I'd be happy to go back to the board and have that conversation.
It's okay. As they stop by, I'll ask.
All right, members, other questions? I'm just reminding you that we're back at 7 o'clock tonight. Representative Lehan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First, I guess I'd like to thank President Blackhurst and Vice President Haller for coming down and telling your story. It's always good for us to hear. I mean, we see the spreadsheets and everything and go through the numbers, but to hear the stories from the campus, so I certainly do appreciate that. And can commiserate with you on the drive down here and everything too. So Chancellor Rosenstone or Vice Chancellor King, I guess can you talk a little bit about enrollment projections, kind of where they've been in the past, where they are now, where they're going in the future?
Rosenstone?
Yes, Chair Nornes, Representative Lehan, thank you for the question. As we discussed in the presentation last month, our enrollment is countercyclical with the economy. The good news in Minnesota is when the economy gets really good and people are all going back to work, they're not coming to our colleges in particular and to some extent our universities as a result. And so our enrollments have been down since the peak of the Great Recession, but they're about the level they were prior to the start of the Great Recession.
Right.
The biggest two drivers of enrollment in our colleges and universities are first, the economy, as I mentioned, the unemployment rate, and secondly, the number of high school graduates. And as you probably know, we've gone through a secular change in Minnesota where the number of high school graduates has dipped. It's at a lowest point it's been in about a decade, and it's going to be about 3 or 4 more years before it starts slowly coming back up. So we've been responding to the demographic and economic changes that have occurred in our state. We're working very hard on new strategies by which we can prevent more Minnesotans from leaving Minnesota to go to college, and there's been a gradual uptick in the number of students going to Wisconsin and the Dakotas. And as you know, from your neck of the woods, there's been very aggressive investments in North Dakota in particular, in recruiting our students to North Dakota, which has hurt Minnesota. And secondly, there's been a very aggressive effort by for-profits, which promise an awful lot, provide very, very high costs to students, astronomical debt to students, and less likelihood of getting placed in great jobs. And we're working hard together to do a much better job of describing the advantages of being at one of our colleges, universities, in an effort to grow enrollments. We're kind of hampered because some of the program development you'd love to see at MSU-Moorhead, and we'd love to see at our other colleges and universities to go after additional enrollments, are hamstrung by the lack of state support to help provide the investment in new programs, investment in new technology and the like. You heard that, for example, from President Parker. So we're kind of between a rock and a hard place. On the one hand, we're getting a clamoring for growing programs, which would not only grow enrollments but meet workforce needs, but we don't have the base dollars to make some of the investments that are critical to both meeting the workforce needs and fighting against the economic and demographic trends on that are influencing our enrollments.
Yep, Representative Lean.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. No, I certainly understand what those four-time, five-time football championships have done to the to the makeup and everything of higher education in the Red River Valley. So can you talk a little bit just about where you see enrollment heading in the next couple years? I can't imagine you can go out 10 years or so, but it's in the next couple years?
Yes.
Ms. King?
Mr. Chair, Representative Lean, we certainly can. We have, I'll dig it out and send it out to you. It was in the last deck, I think. It showed the trends in enrollment between the colleges and universities. And what you saw was a much more pronounced expansion in the colleges and contraction. The universities have been a much more gradual change. In both the colleges and universities, we're projecting flat enrollment for the next several years. And then we expect as a high school graduation rate picks up that that will run to the benefit both of the universities, maybe marginally more than the colleges. The college enrollment is much more tied to the unemployment rate. And the current projections for that have that running pretty steady for the next couple of years. So overall, we're projecting a flat outlook for the next 2 or 3 years. But I will say that we've struggled to get it right because the enrollment has been so sensitive to the economy. So we're hopeful we have it right because it's easier to balance budgets when you don't guess too high on the revenue side.
Representative Lean.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I think we all can agree that at least flat is better than decrease. So that's good to hear. And then I did want to ask about slide 6. It's page 6 in our packet here about that $26.8 million for stemming the growth in tuition and student fees. Can you talk a little bit about, or I guess just provide some additional comments about those dollars in that category?
Certainly, Mr. Chair, Representative Lean. What you have on this slide, and this was also in the data book that we sent you last month, we asked the campuses to tell us both where did you reduce costs and where did you increase costs? And so what you see here is sort of the rolled up sum of that. On this slide, we have, if you look up the four lines up from the bottom, total reinvestments and cuts of $38 million. And above that, $24 million were cuts made to balance the budget. So those were cuts that went away. I mean, those were costs that went away. Right above that is $14 million that was reinvested. So $14 million in expenses somewhere stopped, and they started up doing something else compared to the $24 million of expenses that stopped and didn't start up doing something else. The little schedule you see down below is, as per your reporting instructions, we characterized what kinds of expenses these were. So the $11 million you see invest in direct mission activities, that was likely instruction and directly related to instruction, and $26 million, those could be any combination of the things up above. It could be efficiency improvements, it could be technology gains from an operation standpoint, It could be investments made that translated into utility savings. So there are administrative and efficiency-related things that helped the campuses avoid, had they not been otherwise statutorily prohibited, it would have helped them avoid a tuition increase. That's the construction that we've been asked to put together here.
Thank you.
All right. Representative Pryor.
Thank you, Chair. Following up on some of that previous discussion, can you talk a little bit about, you have fixed costs, and it doesn't matter how many students you have, and then you have the marginal costs. The reductions, I would imagine that there's been some reduction when you have fewer students in your costs. And is that reflected anywhere in any of these numbers, or is there a way to understand that and then to know that when students return, they also help pay for the fixed costs too?
Okay. Certainly, Mr. Chair, Representative. It's absolutely the case that we have a combination of both fixed and variable costs. One of the dimensions that's a complication in our business is that our variable costs, which are our faculty and staff, are what they call lumpy, which is that we add a faculty person for the next 6 or 8 or 12 or 24 students. And if we lose one student, we don't lose one faculty person. So it is not anything close to one for one. Our fixed costs, we've done a lot of work around efficiency investments on fixed costs to lower them because they're substantially tied to our real estate, and we've had trouble building legislative support to get rid of real estate, and so we've got to pay the bill. We've got to heat it, we've got to secure it, we've got to run the electricity. So we've been investing in energy conservation, energy improvement programs to lower that part of our fixed costs.
Any other quick questions? Representative Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So this IT project, very expensive. How much does your current system cost? And if you don't get state money to help you subsidize the new IT project, what are you going to do?
Ms. King?
Mr. Chair, Representative Schultz, our current IT budget is about $40 million a year. I think that's roughly right. I'm looking over at Ross, he's nodding. And that is spent about 85% to maintain all of those 32 different programs that I mentioned, and about 15% to improve the services that are offered through the technology. If we are not successful this session in seeking the state's partnership in replacing this system, we would go back to our presidents and our board and our technology community and regroup. It's not avoidable. We have to do this work. And so, without the state support, it places the organization at much greater risk. It places our students' success at much greater risk. And we would be back to you next year, you can guarantee it, because this is not something that we can reinvent our way out of.
Representative Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I guess I'm concerned with, we already cannot compete with our neighbors in terms of price of tuition. And if we help subsidize, the state helps subsidize this new operating IT system, are you gonna have to increase tuition down the road to cover operating expenses if you don't get sufficient state funds to cover it? And then we'll be even less competitive. And so, you already receive half as much state funding appropriations compared to North Dakota, and much less compared to Wisconsin. So I guess my concern is that you're gonna have another expense that's gonna make us even more uncompetitive.
Chair Nornes, with your permission, Representative Schultz, we share your concern. Our goal is not to find a path that puts us on the back of our students for reasons which you have made crystal clear. But we're kind of between a rock and a hard place here. As a dialogue between Representative Pawlowski and Vice Chancellor King made really clear, we can't put more on our campuses. We can't put more, for reasons you just said, on our students. We need your help, and we can't avoid doing this one. as everybody in this room knows, for a system like this to go a full quarter century without a major replacement is remarkable. But we're on borrowed time at this point. And this system handles everything from registering students to admissions to paying our payroll to paying our bills to getting students transcripts, interfacing with the state of Minnesota system, financial aid, everything grinds to a halt if this thing breaks. And we either do what good, wise people do in situations like this and get ahead of it, or we face a real crisis down the road. And as I told you, it wasn't my dream to bring to you as my last request, a big technology request, but it's one of these must-do projects. And the alternatives here are unacceptable. And we're not proposing using tuition to cover any of these expenses. We're not going back to our students and saying, we need to raise tuition to cover this. We're hoping we'll have a partnership with the state of Minnesota. And as Vice Chancellor King suggested, in a perfect world, we all like the things to be paid by somebody else entirely. We thought it was more credible, appropriate, and reasonable to say we will work together with the state to cover this cost, and it's hard from our point of view. And it may be hard from your point of view too, but sometimes we just got to do hard things because they're the right things to do, and this just happens to be one of those projects.
Representative Shaw.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm just curious, is there a monopoly on these vendors for these IT systems? Are there a lot of vendors that you get bids from to do the upgrade?
Rosenstone.
Chair Nornes, Representative Schultz, indeed we will go to market and we will bid at market. We will have competitive bidding process that meets all the requirements that the state of Minnesota imposes on such a process. We're at a point, as I understand it, in the development of these products where this is a very competitive environment as more vendors are taking the next generation of products to market. And we will do our best to get the best deal for the state of Minnesota for our campuses that we possibly can. The thing you have to note is that this thing that was accomplished 20 years ago was something that no other system in the country accomplished, which is building one system that would serve in a very efficient way the entire state. We are not going to build our own system. Mm-hmm. It is prohibitive to try to build this ourselves, but we will go to market, go to competitive bids, and get the system that will best meet our needs and be the most cost-effective way to do it. And we will get multiple bids, and we will get those bids.
Thank you.
All right. I believe we'd probably come to the end. Oh, I'm sorry. We do have another question. Representative Jessup.
Thank you, Chair. It sounds like from the discussion, we've got three different circles down here, green circles. It seems like the technology system is the priority. Am I correct on that?
Rosenstone.
Chair Nornes, Representative Jessup, it is one of our three priorities. If we get support for the technology system but are cannibalizing our campuses and programs, we got a great foundation but no house to live in. And we can't play them off against each other. We brought you must-do priorities. There's not nice things to do, wouldn't it be lovely ifs. That's not what this list is about. It is very focused on just three priorities. We can't sacrifice the support of our campuses in order to have the technology we need to hold everything together.
Chancellor, just this does not qualify as a HEPR project if it come under bonding.
Mr. Chair, it continues to be the opinion of the executive branch, and it's actually, I'm sure, a stronger opinion today than it was 5 years ago, because it's no longer the case that these technology projects involve in buying equipment. It generally is a license to use someone else's software, and that's not a capital investment.
Okay. Just thought I'd ask. Again, thank you, Chancellor Rosenstone, Ms. King, all of the other testifiers, guests here today, and that will conclude our hearing. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.